Morning, Joan and Mitzi. Morning, Jane. Hi, Liz. Good morning, Mishi. Hi, Robin. Good morning, Permar family, Joe and Gail Scott, Sharon Alaband. Good morning to the Cleavers. Hi, Joyce. Good morning, Jackie and Ed Walton. Good morning, Elizabeth. Good morning to the Gorkos. Happy birthday, Marianne. Good morning, Brenda Hines. Good morning, Pizza Plea. And to the other Mr. Suplee, good morning to you. And somebody who just shows up as the number 9, to whoever that is, good morning to you. I am here by myself, so there is no one to blame technology issues on. So we will see how it goes. But I just tried everything and it worked. So we shall see. I'm going to grab my phone just in case anybody needs to text me for anything. All right. So once again, good morning to everybody. Thank you for joining us. I invite you now to prepare your hearts and minds to worship as we listen to the prelude, When We All Get to Heaven, offered by Chris McGuckin. And I can't see the chat when I'm sharing the screen. So those of you that have my cell phone number, please text me if this does not work. All right, I'm hearing from some of you that you cannot hear the music. Hi, Mom, I see that you're on. Let me check and see. So, my output is as high, it's as loud as it will go. I know the music, Chris's music, does come in soft, so maybe adjust your volume for those of you that can't hear it. Good morning, Joyce Parrott and Karen Wells. I'm going to try it. Try something else. So let's see, share screen. I'm going to try this again. Okay. Thank you. Chris. Please join me in the call to worship. We come to worship you, God, and we long for comfort. In your arms this morning, can our distress subside? In the name of Jesus, you hold us as your children and you promise us life, life eternal, life with you. May these promises guide our thoughts, our prayers, and our worship this morning. Amen. Our first sing-along hymn is Open the Eyes of My Heart, offered by Bill and Mary Lou. And again, please text me if it does not work.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Okay, so there was music but no lyrics. Okay, let's try this again.
Lord, open the eyes of my heart. Of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see.
Call to confession. God is gracious and merciful and knows our needs even before they reach our lips. Still, we engage in confession, admitting to God all that rests uneasily in our hearts. Confident of God's love, let us make our confession first in silent prayer. and together. Sometimes, O God, we forget people, or we toss them aside. The difficult ones, the needy ones, the ones that are hard to spend time with, the ones who confront us. And sometimes when we do things like that, it's not really about the other people, but about us. We are uncomfortable, or we feel guilty, or we follow brighter, shinier people, or we worry about what will make us look good. We are in such desperate need of your forgiveness. We need to be forgiven for our sin, for our mistakes, for mistaking what the world values with what you value. Help us to be better and to see more clearly and to care more thoroughly. In Christ we pray, amen. Friends, hear this good news, the assurance of God's great pardon. The love of God is beyond measure, and you are included in that love. Know that you are forgiven and thus free to love and serve. Alleluia. Amen. There's some beautiful special music on Eagle's Wings offered by Dan Robbins. And again, please let me know.
Of his hand.
Thank you, Dan. That song always reminds me of, whenever I hear that, I think, this is for my mom, I think of Grandpa Serino. So he must have, I must have heard him sing that when I was in church once when I was little, because every time I hear that song, I think of him. Please join me in our prayer for illumination. Living God, help us so to hear your holy word that we may truly understand, that understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first two scripture lessons come to us from the Psalms 18 and 25. For you deliver a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. Our second lessons come to us from Proverbs 11 and 16. When pride comes, then comes disgrace, but wisdom is with the humble. Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And our final lesson comes to us from 1 Peter. And all of you must clothe yourselves with humility in your dealings with one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that God may exalt you in due time. These are the words of the Lord, and thanks be to God. We are wrapping up our sermon series on the seven heavenly virtues. Today we are talking about humility. So the reason I chose so many scripture lessons is that there are so many sayings about pride and humility in the Bible, and most of them are pretty familiar to us. But from the Old Testament times through the era of Jesus and the apostles down throughout Christian history, pride and humility are perhaps the most discussed vice and virtue pair. In today's culture, though, talking about humility is liable to get you looked at funny. It may be the spiritual quality least appreciated in our time. Psychology has taught us the importance of self-esteem, and working life often teaches us the value of self-promotion. In popular culture, humility is treated more like a deadly sin than a heavenly virtue. Humility today seems like a curiosity, something exotic from another time and place, like an Amish buggy on an interstate. Yet we can't ignore the prophets and the sages, not to mention Jesus himself, who have valued humility and pride in ways that turn our culture's assessment on its head. Parents are proud of their children. Patriots are proud of their countries. People want to take pride in their work. So what's the problem then? Why can't we take pride in who we are and what we do? The way we ask that question gets at the heart of the matter. Pride has to do with who we are and with our feelings about who we are. The first thing to consider is that pride is not the same as happiness. We can be happy to be who we are, happy to do what we do, happy with our family, happy with our church, without falling into pride. This kind of happiness is related to the self-esteem that we value as part of being psychologically healthy people. In spiritual terms, this happiness is related to our nature as creatures. God created each individual being with our own reality that is good. As human beings, we are each made in the image of God, an infinite image present in us in an infinite number of individual personalities and characters. To rejoice in being who God has made us is not pride, but a spiritually sound recognition that we are the created of God, on whom we rely for our existence and our reality. It is not pride to feel that we are as God has made us, meaning that we are as we ought to be. Pride enters in when we project this sense of the rightness of our lives onto others in order to receive their acknowledgement or approval. It also enters in when we need to feel that our lives are better than those of others. Pride has to do with demonstrating our value to other people. What we are actually doing nearly every time we do this is demonstrating our value to ourselves. Pride is likely to develop from too little self-esteem rather than too much. We doubt our own value and we want other people to affirm it. So we proudly trumpet our worthiness. We tend to construct our sense of identity not on the basis of who we are in the sight of our Creator, but on the basis of who we imagine we want to be, which is usually who we think other people want us to be. Thomas Merton speaks of having a choice between being real, cooperating with God's creation of our identity as it really is, and being unreal, constructing a false self, the person we think we want to be. He says, "My false and private self is the one who wants to exist outside the reach of God's will and God's love, outside of reality and outside of life. And such a self cannot help but be an illusion." Pride, as it relates to other people, grows out of this false self-constructed self. People with genuine self-esteem, grounded in the recognition of their identity as the image of God, don't need to have their worth constantly affirmed through the approval of other people. Most of us, most of the time, however, are looking for that acceptance and approval, and the obvious way to get it is to elevate the things we have and the self we are pretending to be above what we have come to see as our competition. We elevate our family for our neighbors, our work for our coworkers, our country for our fellow citizens, our religion to our fellow believers, lifting them above the people and parties and enemies and sects who are devalued or despised by our group. Appropriate recognition of the goodness of God's gifts turns into pride almost before we know it. The problem with pride, then, is that it's wrapped up in our alienation from our true identity in God. We build ourselves up in order to stand out, to be recognized and approved, because at the bottom of it, we are afraid that otherwise there will be nothing there. Not trusting the reality of our inmost selves, not relying on our Creator to provide us with our essential truth and identity, we go for pride instead. The more pride we can pile onto ourselves, the less we consider who we might really be behind the mask. We can only be proudly convinced of our superiority if we constantly compare ourselves with other people, even if we never say a word about it to them, and if we deny the reality of our flaws. Once we begin to live as our real selves, given by God and not created as a showpiece to impress others, we can acknowledge our flaws, the places where we are still growing into our God-given reality, without fear or denial. As our real selves, we have no pride because we know that our reality is a gift and not something we achieved on our own. We quit comparing ourselves with others because we no longer care if our self, our reality, is better than anyone else's. And this brings us to humility. If pride develops from a false sense of self, rooted in a denial of our actual reality, then humility must involve an acceptance of that God-given self. Humility does not mean thinking of ourselves as worthless. It means acknowledging that we are uniquely made in the image of God, no more and no less. Humility does not mean considering ourselves worse than other people rather than better. It does not even mean making a realistic evaluation of ourselves. Humility has nothing to do with self-evaluation. That's because evaluation implies comparison with a standard, and humility means giving up comparison altogether. No humble person is compared with how he or she compares with other people. Humility brings about an utter loss of interest in this subject. And humility does not mean considering ourselves better or worse than others. Humility results from knowing ourselves in relation to God. It arises from an awareness of ourselves as created, as finite beings before the infinite and loving God who gives us our existence. Out of this consciousness, no pride can flow. Comparison with this standard would be ridiculous. Our individual characteristics are not an issue either. We are simply what everything else is that is not God. In the presence of the Creator we worship, we give thanks and we are humble. In a similar way, humility arises from our awareness of Christ both as Redeemer and model. Since we know that our standing before God is not of our own making or earning, but is freely given to us in Jesus, boasting, the Apostle Paul writes in his letter to the Romans, boasting is excluded. Both the teaching of Jesus on humility and our knowledge of him as the divine word who humbly entered into human flesh provide us with a pattern and an incentive toward humility. This is the root of humility, an awareness of ourselves as creatures among other creatures, with no standing but that of grace. Its branches extend outward from this awareness into all our relationships. Once we have recognized the immensity of divine love and mercy and the absolute difference between created and creator, the distinctions between one and another lose their significance. Without this sense of differences to be evaluated to rank one person above another, we no longer try to rate ourselves by reference to other people. We accept ourselves and our worth simply as given by God, and we regard everyone else in the same way. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me as we affirm what we believe. We believe and know that Jesus is the Holy One of God. We believe that he is the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. We believe that he is in the Father and the Father is in him. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing we have life in his name. Amen. Next hymn is At Calvary. So again, if you could text me if you can't see the lyrics or hear the sound.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me, he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. My burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. True salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.
Thank you, Bill and Mary Lou. Thanks to all of you from both churches for your continued generosity. It has been amazing that in this past however many months of this pandemic, 16, 17 months of this pandemic, the ways in which your generosity has continued to allow both churches to do the work of God out in the communities, just as we were called to do. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Mighty God, you overwhelm us with your great mercy. You surprise us with your wondrous love. As you draw us into this renewing relationship of love, may we respond with gratitude as we offer the substance of our souls to continue the ministry of Jesus. In his name we present our gifts. Amen. This is the time when we share with one another those things that bring us great joy and also those things that weigh heavy on our hearts. You all know how to use the chat feature by now. You can also text me, but let me know your joys and concerns. prayers for the Larkin family. Jen, who we've been praying for, died of a brain tumor this week. So prayers for the Larkin family. May God hear our prayers for that. John Christopher and Lindsay got married yesterday. Their cousins being lifted up by the gummy bear king. Nancy, Marlowe's friend who continues with radiation. Prayers for her. From Bonnie, prayers for all in Miami. The rescuers, the survivors, those who don't know, those who have heard devastating news. Prayers for Sam Permar, who heads to sleepaway camp next weekend. Sam, you're going to have a great time. That'll be really, really fun. So we look forward to hearing about it when you get back. So prayers for Sam. And prayers for his parents, because it's always harder on the parents than the kids. I take Katie today for a week of Girl Scout camp. She's gone with her cousin every year since the girls were, I think, 9 was the first year they went. And now they're 15, so. What I'm doing this afternoon. All right. We lift up all those prayers and the prayers that remain unspoken in our hearts. We lift them up using the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. So I want to celebrate Mary Ann's birthday and the other June birthdays. You know, Sue Menarche's is tomorrow. Rob McPherson's was last Monday. Karen Wells had a June birthday. I'm trying to remember all the other June birthdays. We had a lot of June birthdays. So here is the tingling song. Well, maybe not. Let's try it again.
For the crowd to yell happy birthday.
Oh, birthday song, we sing a ling a ling with all our hearts to you. We hope there'll be something a ling a ling that we can do for you. In autumn, winter, spring a ling a ling, and all the whole year through. This little song will sing a ling a ling, a birthday song to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
All right. So thank you all for being with me today, with each other. I see Cindy Engel has joined, and Jen Nielsen, the Hornados, so all the people that I didn't get to say hi to, or Karen Stats, all the people I didn't say hi to earlier, please know how excited I am to have you here with me. So thank you all. As you go on to your week, go now knowing that the love of God surrounds you anywhere and everywhere that you might go. Amen. Thank you all for being here. next week. Thank you, Pete. Next week, Unionville. So Doe Run's already back in its building. Doe Run, we'll be back in our building at Unionville. Thank you, Pete. Your encouragement every week has been amazing. Thank you so much. So next week, we will be in our building. We will be having some kind of live streaming opportunity for those who can't come back into the building or are far away. But hopefully the rest of us, we will see you there. Thanks to everybody for being here, for all your encouragement along the way. Oh, I forgot about Ellie Lewis's birthday on June 25th. That's another June birthday that we had. So thank you, everybody. Enjoy. Enjoy your week. Thank you, Liz and Karen and Sharon Alaband and Pete, everybody that's offered chats of encouragement. Thank you very much for that. It's nice to be encouraged and appreciated. So thank you all. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. And hopefully I will see you in the building next Sunday. Bye-bye.